demon right after we hear what they had to say about each other.
Do you know your first opponent?
My first opponent is this demon.
I think I have a great chance to win. I just watched his preliminary match against Gladial, and that's all I know about him.
His hunter is faster than mine.
Grage, my future opponent, have really weird deck list.
I'm not afraid of his lineup. It's pretty standard.
We're gonna see a lot of French players perform well in tournaments.
I can't be 100% sure, but other games will be okay.
If I play correctly and I have this bit of luck necessary, I think I can win.
Dressed to win and chills a breeze, ladies and gentlemen, it's Frodo and Savitz. Welcome back to the caster's desk. It's time for the A-team to bring you guys the third quarterfinal of the day. Hope you guys are enjoying it. Savitz, how you doing, man? Welcome back to America. Good to have you.
I'm doing great. I'm happy to be back here. And exciting match ahead of us, this Demon and Great J. Both are relative unknowns to the viewers back home, probably. But this Demon was my personal pick to maybe even take this entire tournament here. And he's bringing a solid lineup. He is bringing a Rogue and Great J with that only Paladin of the tournament.
Yep. You have a horse in the running in Diz Demon. He is a player that's been competing for a long time. So if you're part of the French community, you've heard his name before. In fact, if you are also a StarCraft fan, and maybe a very hardcore StarCraft fan, you may have also seen his names in the Grandmasters ranking. This guy has been competing for a long time. His opponent, Grey J, still pretty new to the scene. He's only been playing for about a year. We've gotten several of those stories in the Hearthstone Championship Tour, and that's always heartwarming because you don't have to always be playing Hearthstone since the very beginning to be able to compete on a stage like this.
Yep, and here we go. That is going to be the Paladin deck from Grey J to kick things off, and this Demon playing his Rogue.
All right, so Paladin in a very interesting spot. They have a couple of variants that people tend to gravitate toward. The control, Nuzoth, defensive type of Paladin. And then we have this Murloc Paladin, which is starting to gravitate more towards a faster variant, maybe less healings and less defensive play and a little bit more proactive play. How do you feel about the Paladin state in the metagame, especially when it goes up against these weirder decks like Rogue?
I think it's quite all right. You have the tools to deal with something like a Conceal with your Wild Pyromancer Equality or maybe Equality Consecration. So the tools are there. It can be a little bit slow at times, and usually it's only the second anything that gets your opponent. So maybe against a Druid, for example, it might be a little bit too slow. The Malygos might come a little bit earlier than the second anything can happen. But I think that Great J does have a good chance here in game one.
Yeah, we've seen Murloc Paladin have mixed success here in the Hearthstone Championship Tour, ranging anywhere from being wildly inconsistent and ineffective to winning the tournament outright. So I like a bold pick from Grey J, but his choices across the board do seem very interesting. We'll talk more about it, not just the Paladin, but, you know, Nuzoth Hunter, which, yeah, of course, is a very interesting choice. And, you know, Grey J also banned his Demon's Hunter, too. Something that a lot of people were flirting with the idea of. They're like, they don't really want to play against Shaman, but what's the second likely candidate for bans? And a lot of them actually were thinking about Hunter.
Yeah, I mean, Grey J was a little bit worried that maybe this Demon's Hunter would be faster than he is because of, like, you know, like the Nuzoth that you mentioned. While it can be extremely powerful, it is extremely slow. Mm-hmm. So that might have been a problematic matchup for him. This Demon here, thinking his time on turn one. Nothing to play there, obviously. I mean, he's playing Rogue. But I do still think that it's very good to kind of take things slow, just because you might be a little bit nervous playing on the big stage and all that. So just kind of settling in and thinking about the future turns as well.
Yeah, you know, taking the first couple of turns to really plan out his Rogue is pretty important. But, you know, also just kind of just reminding yourself, a lot of players during these phases of the turns just tend to talk to themselves internally, like dialogue, like, what are some of the cards I'm looking for? What are some of the important turns to really focus on? You know, for example, Rogue's always looking for a Tomb Pillager on turn four. That's one of the big important engines that really pushes their deck. So just constantly reminding yourself, because if you're always caught up in just the turns in the moment, you sometimes tunnel too much. Look no further than just in a recent series with the Freeze Mage games. Like, sometimes you're tunneling so much on just not losing because you're, like, playing Freeze Mage against Rogues. Like, I don't really lose this matchup. Maybe sometimes you can just kill him straight up. So you don't want to tunnel too hard in these games.
Yeah, that Miss Lethal right there didn't really matter in the end. He had the game, but it's still, like, something that Maybe if he was playing back at home at this comfortable setting, I mean, maybe he would have spotted it.
All right, so Dizdemon just goes for the hero powers. It could also be the strategy where he's just trying to maximize the time given. We had a couple of ropers coming through the HCT entrance. Some of them have had success, some of them haven't.
Yep, questing adventurers. He's finding something here that it's probably not the time for it just yet. You don't want to be burning it through your stuff too quickly, but it's a nice card to have, and he does have a conceal already, and with the preparation, it could get pretty big pretty fast.
Rogue has traditionally been able to punish heavily decks that are super passive.
Yep.
Has that changed changed at all with the questing adventurer list, you feel?
I think the questing adventurer list actually punishes even more, because you can put so much pressure early on with an early conceal, for example. Some classes might not have good tools to deal with it. For example, druids don't necessarily even play multi in their deck, so if you get like a 5-5 questing adventurer on the board early on, it can be very difficult to deal with. Because Swipe, for example, wouldn't kill it.
You know what blows my mind is that Rogues are also beginning to cut cards like SI7 Agent from their list. And that was one of the iconic cards of the class, along with Sap and Eviscerate Preparation. Why are they cutting these amazing 3-mana minions? It's because there's too many 3-mana minions to play with Questing Adventurers?
I guess that's just too many. So many 3-drops do really fit the Rogue class very well, but Questing Adventure now, especially with Barnes, it has really kind of like found its place, I suppose. There's even more good Barnes outcomes now, because you can. It's not just getting that Auctioneer or getting maybe Doom Pillager for an extra coin, but also just getting that Questing Adventure on the board early on can lead to some quick wins. This Demon, there are 3 turns in a row, he has roped.
Yeah, I mean, it also could be a mind game too. I mean, this Demon, he's been on competitive stages before for other games. We mentioned StarCraft, for example. Greyjay's still kind of new to it all. He just said that a friend introduced him to Hearthstone and started playing for a year, not really being competitive, and then all of a sudden was like realizing that he was getting a lot better than his friends, started trying to compete more often, and then now he's here in the preliminary playing his weird stuff. And it could be feeding into just the lack of experience. You know, you start getting tilted and start getting annoyed at your opponent. Start focusing a little bit less on the games.
It's going to make Greyjay make some mistakes potentially, like if he wants to. Because he's known for playing extremely quickly, so like maybe he would get frustrated and just like kind of slip up at some point.
It's true. People who play fast tend to also get extra annoyed at people who play slow.
Absolutely. Yeah. And well, this is like, I think it's kind of like the first turn for this demon where there's an actual decision. Like, he could just go for the questing adventure right now, and looks like he is going to do it. That means that we're also going to see the preparation here. He does have to go with the conceal as well, otherwise that the questing adventure would potentially just die to a true silver champion.
Yeah, there you go. And because the stealth also is unable to be targeted by Alder Peacekeeper, and Greyjay just has to let that questing adventure stay, and that it's a lot of explosive potential. Wow, coin, wow. Solemn Vigil. He says, I need a way to deal with this in the next couple of turns, maybe pick up the Pyromancer.
Yeah, certainly not the way that you usually want to play your draw 2 cards. I mean, compared to like Arcane Intellect, he had to burn the coin there, also missing out on the hero power. But for his defense, there wasn't any great player available for him. And like you said, he needs to find a way to deal with that questing as fast as possible.
Yeah, I mean, does have way to deal with it this next turn with the Alder Peacekeeper, but that's already after the damage is done. And also, it's a very temporary band-aid, because the Questing Adventure will continue to grow with every single card being played.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. He might even have to consider something like Equality Bluegill just to completely remove it from the board.
Oh, man.
But that's not how you want to be using your Equality. Like, Wild Pyromancer is the card that Greyjay is hoping to draw next.
Okay, well, the demon already committed to the attack, so anything else at this point would be either misdamaged or if he just kind of changes his mind halfway through.
Yeah, no.
Oh, he gets the Wild Pyromancer.
So this game just got a... Oh, he's not going to go for it, though.
He's going to be a little bit greedy.
Okay.
Well, I think he was maybe anticipating his opponent's hand to be a little bit more all-in at that point. You know, if they play in Questing Adventure, they use 3 or 4 cards early on. Perhaps they have Cold Bloods to follow it up. So maybe he feels like, yeah, I'm a little bit safer. I have Tyrion Ragnaros, I have Equality and Pyromancer, and Ivory Knight. Very defensive cards.
Yeah.
I have time that I could probably climb back if he can't burst me.
Regardless of that, like the Wild Pyromancer was definitely a great pickup. Like, there will be a moment for it later. But now, if you're this demon, you might feel like maybe that questing on the board would already be enough of a threat, but he is going to just go for the preparation and the fan here, and Greyjay being patient with the Wild Pyromancer equality is going to get rewarded.
Yep, not before some more damage gets put in, though.
Yeah, that's true.
At least 8 more, putting your opponent down to 16. And Dizdemon also picks up another Auctioneer with the Azure Drake as well, so there's still more card draw engine. That's one of the things Rogue fears the most.
Yep, and very quick Wild Pyro equality here. Nothing to think about. I guess with the last two mana, he could be considering hero powering Blue Kill or the Blood Mage Thanos. He's choosing to go with the Blood Mage just to kind of like cycle and maybe improve his options for the next turn.
Yeah, Blood Mage Thanos, a very interesting inclusion as well. You know, most of the time you see like a 2 Loot Hoarder list and then he chooses to split one with the Blood Mage Thanos. What's the thinking here, Sabid?
It's actually quite impactful sometimes when you get to do it with in combination with Consecration. Having the 3 damage AoE instead of the 2 damage can make a huge difference, especially against something like Shaman, where there's Tunnel Jogs and Feral Spirits, a lot of three toughness minions. It's also an additional card draw, so like we, well, some players have like kind of added it as an extra cycle on top of two Loot Hoarders, but we do see that one Loot Hoarder has been cut. To make space for it in this case. But yeah, it does trade a little bit worse for early minions. Like if your opponent plays a 3-2, you would much rather have a Loot Hoarder in that case to be able to get that trade off. So I don't know if it's better than Loot Hoarder, but in some cases, certainly.
Yeah, plus you never know what you pick off Ivory Knight. Maybe that ends up helping you there.
Also true.
For now, Greyjay has very clean turn, just removing this Azure Drake with the 4 damage source, setting up Doomsayer so that way he can, you know, in the best case scenario, have a very clean 8 mana minion just pop onto the board.
Yep, very strong play here. That's I would say it's as good as it gets there with that 7 mana. For next turn, he can play an 8 drop on an empty board, but considering that he's playing against a Rogue, I think it's an easy decision to go for the Ragnar's Light Lord instead of Tyrion to play around Zap in particular.
Looking at if Dizdemon has a clean way to remove everything and play the Van Cleef, it looks like he's just a little bit off mana, if I've counted correctly. Because, you know, mm-hmm. you can present a really big threat. You're with this play, you're anticipating that your opponent has a very big 8 mana minion to play, so obviously you want to disrupt it by playing your own big minion instead.
So Shadow Strike backstep unfortunately doesn't work on that Doomsayer, so he would have to use the Eviscerate or Deadly Poison. Yeah. It's a difficult turn. And this is certainly a turn that I'm not surprised to see anybody be roping, because does require quite a lot of consideration. He's just going to choose to let the Doomsayer go off and hope for no Ragnaros Light Lord, but there it is.
Yeah, Ragnaros Light Lord, really powerful. Just to not only heal, but also threaten damage per turn. And if you can't cleanly remove it, he can heal himself, and he keeps getting that repetitive 8 damage every turn.
That is absolutely huge for Greyjay. We can see the card, so the Tyrion would have worked out just fine as well, because there is no Zap, but you have to play around the Zap.
So Shadow Strike Eviscerate will kill Ragnaros Light Lord, and that gives you 4 mana remaining, allow you to play the Deadly Poison and the Van Cleef as well. So that could generate your own 8-8 minion remove and start pushing damage right back.
Trying to see if there's like a way to maybe get the Barnes on the board as well, but it can't quite kill it with just like a backstep and the Eviscerate. So after removing the Light Lord, he can only get 1 minion on the board.
What's the minion that you're really searching for with Barnes this late into the game? If anything, just maybe a Tomb Pillager for your Gadget Sand or what?
Yeah, that would be okay. Or like the last questing adventure maybe. But it's pretty optimistic. And I kind of like this. Just going for the extra card draw. Yeah. He had a chance to pick up a preparation, in which case he could have maybe been able to get something more on the board. Maybe the Van Cleef, but does not find a prep. Oh, yeah, actually, I believe he did play both of his preparation very early on, though. So that was not possible.
Yeah, he had the early questing adventurer preparation, and then he had the Azure Drake prep Fan and Knives, I believe.
That's right.
Or the Auctioneer prep Fan and Knives. Yeah. So Greyjay now has, you know, more removal for this Auctioneer. Has to start kind of thinking about how much Murlocs he's played, because he has the Anyfin. He drew the second Bluegill, and I believe that's 8 damage that he has just for the 10 mana.
Yep.
So he was just counting to see if there's a possibility if he can hit face twice and force his opponent out, because we do know that Rogue doesn't really play healing anymore, especially since the Urthering Farseer just hasn't seen play for a long time. But it's not not possible, so.
No, and leaving the auctioneer, it's just so dangerous, giving all those free cards, and Zap on the blue color, something like that would have actually been like a possible play, kind of like to stop the anything from happening.
Zap on the blue kill.
Well, maybe not. I mean, yeah.
In a really weird world, that might actually end up being the play.
I mean, zapping a 2-mana charge, but you can't play both that and the anything next turn, so I would have stopped that. But this demon here, now he's going to go for the barns, maybe hoping for
questing adventure.
That's one of the best, if not the best card for him to pick up here. Wow, that is great for this demon.
So now he can remove.
Yep, and this is going to be the Van Cleef turn, I believe. Like, you can't really pass up on it, I think.
Absolutely, just put as much pressure as you can. So that way you're the one presenting the damage, and if your opponent plays anything, he has to spend it removing.
Yep, and
I apologize. Two war leaders were played.
There were two war leaders, yeah, so that is actually just going to do it. Exactly lethal.
Oh, that was really well played then. I miscounted.
Wow, me as well. I thought it was one war leader only, but wow. Great, Jay, with that anything. So, you see? Sapping the blue gill. That's what he needed to do.
Oh, you're right! You need to sap the blue gill! Oh my goodness. That changed the entire last couple turns perfectly, because, you know, I was actually counting too and thinking about whether or not he would actually do damage with the weapon over two turns. And actually, that would have been lethal even if it was 8 damage. But then you would leave up the gadget in action here, which is too risky.
Yeah.
So this is a very well-played game. And, you know, he mentioned about how comfortable he's with his deck. So a job well done. So that's going to wrap up our first game. When we come back, we're going to have game number 2. So hang tight, guys. We'll be right back.
So tell me a little bit about your team. Are all your teammates French?
Yeah.
It's a full French team. France has had a lot of great players.
Yes.
What's the competitive Hearthstone community like?
Each month in France, big tournaments played on stage at Paris. Most of the French players are really close. And I think in the next year, a lot of French players perform well in tournaments. I think the French players are testing a lot of matchups, a lot of tech. It still doesn't really pay off, but it will soon enough.
Are you going to be the player to put France on the map?
I hope so.
You have a competitive background in other games.
I played a lot to StarCraft II. I reached Grandmaster League, and I really think that helped me to improve in Hearthstone. In StarCraft II and in Hearthstone, you really need to sync to every one of your moves. I think that really helps me.
Welcome back, everybody, to Game 2. I have been demoted to the B team. Savitz, you're going to cast this solo for the rest of the series.
Oh, no.
after that interesting finish. A job well done, by the way, to Greyjay again for being able to plot it out. You know, Rogue does tend to have the upper hand against a lot of those slower decks. So Greyjay already getting off to a good start. And he's got some of those other weird curveballs ready to go. He's got his Control Warrior with Yogg-Saron. He's got his Hunter with N'Zoth, the Corruptor.
Yeah, I'm really curious to see how the N'Zoth plays out. I believe he has to get the right matchup for it. If he queues his Hunter into a Warrior, he's probably going to be doing great. But what we have at our hands is going to be a Control Warrior mirror match.
And it's been a while, man. Yeah. It's been a while since we've seen Control Warrior versus Control Warrior to the point where it's kind of like down memory lane, so to speak. This matchup has a lot of areas that you can mess up, and that's probably why a lot of Warrior players actually really like this.
Yeah, there's a lot of approaches to this as well. Like, do you start avoiding card draw from the early on already, kind of like trying to stay ahead on the card count, maybe so your opponent would fatigue first? Or do you maybe play your hand a little bit faster and just go for a quick golden monkey? So the way that this usually works is that the early game is extremely like slow paced, and there might be quite a bit of hero powering. But as the game progresses, like the golden monkey showdown, it's going to be epic. It always is.
I love it. And they both have Elite Star Seeker, golden Elite Star Seekers for the actual golden monkeys. If you don't have a golden version of Elite Star Seeker in your collection, or even in your decks as you play it, you are a heretic. You need to have your golden monkey actually golden.
It's so, and you even get the golden map to the golden monkey. What a value there.
So it is, man. It's like getting infinite card value.
If there's, only one card you craft in gold, I think Elise is a good choice.
Elise is a good choice. Yaxxon is also a good choice. All the spells go in gold as well. So yeah, you mentioned that there will be a lot of hero powering, and the armor count really does matter. I think going first does tend to give you the armor count advantage significantly. And also the fact that Dizdemon has Jessica Trueheart in his opening hand. That's actually one of the few mulligans you go super hard for in this matchup.
Oh yeah, if you could choose only one card in your starting hand, it would absolutely be Jessica Trueheart in this particular matchup, because you know that there won't be any early aggression, so having something like Fire Warax, which, by the way, is like the greatest card to have in many other matchups. In this one, it doesn't really do all that much.
Yeah, it pretty much kills just Ravaging Ghouls, and if their opponent's bold enough to play Acolyte on the board. And it's also cool because the matchup evolves at different states as well. Like you said, sometimes you actually do want to play faster if your hand kind of dictates it. Yep. Say you play Elise Starseeker on 4, and then you draw the map, and it's like, oh, wow, actually I can play a little bit faster. There are instances where being aggressive and more tempo-oriented can out-resource your opponent. They can't keep up with the wave of threats of early legendaries.
I think that what you would really want to do is you kind of like want to limit the card draw if it's possible. But sometimes things might not be going your way. Maybe you have a full hand and you just like need to make something happen. You know that the late game is not going to favor you anyway. So you just take that as fast as possible Golden Monkey strategy and just like go for it. Don't avoid the card draw. Don't really mind the fatigue as much. Just play the monkey and I hope to get some good stuff.
There's also another advantage for players going first is that the player going second has more cards because of the coin, so they often have to dump. And it's like you said, you might end up seeing the point where both players just hold until 9 cards every turn, and the moment they draw a 10th card, they throw their least important card out. Maybe, the Ravaging Ghoul, maybe the Revenge, these kinds of things.
Like something like Revenge is very common that people just like throw away or just maybe equip your weapon and just like pass, maybe go face, even though the 3 damage doesn't matter that much. Here.
Would you equip the weapon or no?
Probably not. I don't think it really serves any purpose. And he might want to go directly for the Gore Hull. But I wouldn't hate it either, but it seems a little bit unnecessary. He doesn't have the coin. He only has 7 cards in his hand right now. So there aren't any real issues with just keeping it for now.
I do want to say that in terms of the deck list and how they match up, we did mention that Dizdemon is bringing the N'Zoth version, which has death rattles such as Infested Tauren to really help supplant it, like Cairn Bloodhoof, giving a lot of value. And then Greyjay has Yogg-Saron, so I feel like Greyjay, because he's playing a lot more spells-oriented stuff, will be in a pretty big disadvantage because he's got things like Bloods Ichor, which won't exactly be that impactful versus his opponent, who has more like meaty stuff to present as threats.
And even the Yogg-Saron, as powerful as it can be, it quite often draws cards, and drawing cards might not be something that you really want in this matchup. So Yogg overall might be a card that you just never play, and you just try to switch it to a different legendary just to like avoid the card draw.
Oh, so you would convert Yogg-Saron. You have him go through the Golden Monkey manufacturer process. Okay.
Just try to get something else from here. So just like by looking at the deck list, I would favor this demon in this with his N'Zoth list. N'Zoth, it's really powerful when you get it off to respawn something like a Cairn and Sylvanas, obviously. But there is that brawl, and there's usually a lot of removal available, but it does kind of like often give you a kind of a card advantage there just going forward.
Okay, just making sure that Elise can't get any value in killing off whatever could be summoned through Iron Forge Portal. It's like you said, when does Fiery Warax really get a lot of value in this matchup? It's difficult.
Doesn't. Yeah, like in combination with Slam, you can remove some minions, but then again, like both players usually have more removal than the opponent has threats no matter what, so it's fine to play here. Even with the Gore Hull in his hand, he obviously had like the option to just use both of the Fire Warax charges maybe before playing the Gore Hull. Here, anything else but the Justicar would be very shocking, I think.
Yeah, Justicar on 6 is extremely powerful just to start hero powering as soon as you can every single turn. Getting that armor advantage does just end up winning you the game early on. And you can kind of see the difference too already starting to shape up by the fact that this demon will be taking 9 willingly from the least, but still be not too far behind the armor count.
Justicar is going to help catch back up on the life totals, and this also curves out kind of well into either Gore Hull or Ironforge Portal and the tank up.
Greyjay has a removal, and You know, cards like Shield Block also. Yeah, you want to gain armor, but do you really want to dig deeper into your deck?
Usually you don't. You just try to hold on to that as long as possible. And this game definitely looks like it's going to be a long one, so to say. Like, neither player is unlikely to go for that, like a card draw strategy.
And oh, interesting.
Oh, that's really interesting. I'm actually not sure why he would do this. Because, like, at 9 mana, you can get both the tank up and equip the Gorehowl, and, like, what is he gonna remove with that? So I maybe would have preferred like Ironforge Portal tank up, but his opponent does have a lot of cards in his hand. So if you played the Ironforge Portal, I guess a removal would have been a usable card for a Great J. While now he kind of struggles to find a play. So I don't mind the Gorehowl too much.
Yeah, because he has too many cards.
Yep.
So what is he gonna do here? Cycle one of his cards? Perhaps just throw out the coin?
Yeah, not bad at all. I mean, I would probably be looking at that, just throwing away the coin. He was hovering over the Acolyte, so maybe he is considering something like just trying to like draw some, but I don't know about that. Like,
yeah. Acolyte can really ruin your entire game plan, considering that if you just throw it out, your opponent can mess with it through Ravaging Ghouls. Yeah. You know that he has Slam. Of course, we know the Ravaging Ghoul Revenge would be disastrous to draw too many cards.
And like the only card that can really be used in an offensive manner here to attack his opponent is the Chromas, so like I would probably just throw away the coin.
Yeah.
And Great J seems to agree, and he's just gonna do that.
He's not desperate enough to just throw out Revenge or Ravaging Ghoul just yet. So Dizdemon getting that initiative, and this is again one of those things where we're talking about going first. You have that little edge because you can just throw it out there.
Yep. Still, like, thinking about the Gorehowl equip just a tiny bit, like, did you need it? Like, you could have just done it the next turn. Here, I believe, that Great J doesn't have any, like, good proactive plays, I think you skip the Ironforge Portal and just go for the tank up and kind of, like, force Great J to making another awkward turn.
Yeah, I think it's just like you said, by playing Ironforge Portal, you give your opponent ability to use his removal spells, like Bash.
Yeah, so, like, something like Bash that now would maybe be forced to just be thrown away is now something that he has to just like use inefficiently.
Not bad. Pretty good considering you know, it could be a lot worse. There's 1/1s that you don't want from the Ironforge Portal. And I guess that's the bar that I set whenever I play Ironforge Portal.
I think that's pretty much the average result. Like getting a 4/4 or like a 3/5. 4/5 is like slightly above average. And sometimes you might get the Flame Wraithed Faceless, but yeah, I mean that's only one card.
Yeah, sometimes the Hungry Dragon, sometimes a little bit better. But the Gorehowl takes care of everything.
Yep.
And Dizdemon's going to make it up with that tank up. Great J once again on the play here. He needs to do something.
Oh, man. Finds Yorkzaron. So if Great J really does not want to play any of his cards here, but he's going to have to because he does have a full hand, so maybe just the Chrome Faith Base before. He knows it's not going to stick around. There will be either Execute or a Shield Slam.
Yep, this shows flexibility in his understanding of like how this matchup goes. You can already tell that both these guys are really accommodated with like or accustomed to the matchup. They're making sure not to overextend resources, not drawing too fast.
Yep.
But Grommash is rarely used as that finisher. It really is just damage at one point, or even removal.
Oh, yeah.
You just like remove something that's really annoying from your opponent. Back when people played the smaller minions, Grom could just easily attack it, trade, and then get executed.
Yeah, like you said, I also like it just being used as maybe a removal on some kind of minion that has been played. Maybe like just killing off Ravaging Ghoul and then just seeing the execute happen.
Right.
So it's just not going to stick around. This demon here, Ravaging Ghoul, execute an option. He could also go for the Revenge.
Sure. Allows him to just use Revenge in a spot where it doesn't really get much otherwise. So that's fine too.
Like once again, like avoiding the playing any minions though. Oh, that's a decent pickup for Great J, because now he is able to kind of like skip his turn without wasting any of his cards.
That's what it's come down to, just trying to pass without trying to use any of your resources.
Pretty much. I wouldn't be surprised if it just saw like a tank up pass here too, and no care.
He's at 9 cards, so he can just afford to do it one more turn and then force Great J to do something.
He could do it, yeah, but I mean, I wouldn't mind the care either. It is pretty sweet to like drop an empty board, and if there was something like Sylvana Shield Slam, he could just make the same move and steal it back.
Oh man, is it really that time?
Oh man.
Wow, super fast Yogg-Saron.
Mind control maybe?
Mind control would be nasty.
There hasn't been that many spells. Let's see how it works out.
It's been like, I can't even remember. It just feels like like four or five. Oh, no, never mind. Just three spells.
Wow, what a crazy Yogg right there. Three spells buff his opponent's gear in Lava's face.
That, wow. Yeah. That was such a tease.
I mean, it didn't backfire at least, so there's that. Something like Sprint would have been a disaster, or obviously the Astral Communion to discard his entire hand.
Yeah, I feel like there definitely could have been a lot more worse outcomes. He shredded his opponent's armor count down a little bit.
Yep. But that could be another easy target for the Gore Howler. If he wants to save his life total, he could also choose to Shield Slam. But yeah, I like using the weapon here. Like, life total is not really something that he has to be too worried about at this stage. He's still at 30. I mean, 30 is like obviously very good, but his opponent does have quite a bit more.
Yeah, it was at 50 the previous turn. Now hanging out at 45.
Yep. I think that the game at this stage, like Great J probably wants to draw with this. Oh, he's not gonna draw with it. Okay. I'm just like, I think that Great J is not doing so well in this situation. So, if I was Great J, I would at least be considering like kind of like switching gears here and maybe just go for the fast monkey.
Yeah. He already played at least Starseeker, so the monkey map is at least in the deck.
I don't really feel like he has a very good chance with this particular hand in like a very long game, but we'll see. Maybe it works out.
All right, Ironforge portal. Another Elite Starseeker. Of course, you don't get the map off of that summon from the Ironforge portal.
Nope, battle cry does not go off. Yep.
You know, one thing that I actually really like about Greyjoy's play is he recognizes Yogg-Saron can have an impact, both positively and negatively, but the more spells he plays, the higher chance it has to negatively impact him, because you're inevitably going to hit card draw spells. So better to play Yogg-Saron early, and in the best case scenario where your opponent like trades his Cairn or does some other stuff or doesn't have a minion, you might be able to get some more damage into the minion body.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. Greyjoy here. Well, he could bash that and hit it with the weapon. It's probably what he will do. This is just it's gonna be a really rough game for Greyjoy. I mean, the game is still kind of early, but Greyjoy is in a lot of trouble because like this demon is doing so well that he might even win this like without monkeying and just saving his Nozot potentially for Greyjoy's potential monkey. That would be a huge moment because like before the Nozot has been played from this demon, it's almost like Greyjoy can't even play his Golden Monkey because it's just going to be so powerful with Sylvanas and all the Death Rattles.
Oh man, Pitlord, another really strong option as well.
Definitely one of the better ones.
Yep, just Shield Slam has a lot of removal options. Even if he didn't have it, he still has Execute. I'm still looking to pick up Jessicar True Heart or potentially his own Gore Howl to start whacking away as well.
Oh, there's the Nozoth.
Nozoth right now brings back just Cairn, I believe. I don't believe any Infested Torrens were played despite two being in the deck.
If I was this demon, I would 100% hold on to that. Probably like never play it unless there is the Golden Monkey from Greyjoy's side.
Mm-hmm.
No need to play anything, right? He has 9 cards in his hand, so.
Yeah, 12 cards remaining in this demon's deck. We're a little bit over halfway, people. A little bit over halfway. Maybe not even. Depends on how deep we go into the fatigue situation. And it will go to fatigue.
Yeah, it will. Blood to Igor. Such a miserable card. It doesn't really do anything. All it's good for is to be replaced by a random legendary.
Yeah, I can anticipate that with double revenge and Blood to Ikers. This was supposed to be targeted more at the aggressive strategy that would be coming at him, but was not able to line it up. And instead, he just got one of the slower decks that are currently in the lineups.
Yeah, not only is the matchup a little bit like bad for Greyjoy. In my opinion, he also had the worst start of the two players. In particular, this demon picking up that early Justicar while Greyjoy didn't even get it. It's quite impactful.
Now, one thing that also I really like about this matchup is that even though Sylvanas is great, usually in control mirrors, specifically in this matchup too, Gorha is also a pretty good draw for Greyjoy.
Yep.
Is that Sylvanas does tend to become a liability as the game draws on as well, because if you play Sylvanas on empty board and not immediately Shield Slam her or do something impactful, your opponent can force you to take their Acolyte of Pain and then make it draw.
Yeah, multiple cards too.
Yeah.
So quite often you kind of want to hold on to the Sylvanas and maybe use it in combination with the Shield Slam to steal a meaningful minion from your opponent.
Yeah, so despite the fact that normally Sylvanas coming back with Zoth's amazing thing, that might be put on hold for a while as well. That's why you might see Sylvanas just on the bench until further notice.
This demon just playing the ghoul into the weapon.
Still no sign of Justicar.
Yeah. No signs of Justicar, and just like the armor totals are really starting to favor this demon quite heavily at this stage, and it's only gonna get worse.
Is it time for Gromash to come out here for this demon?
I think so.
Just to send him out.
Seems like the only play that isn't kind of like wasteful. Bashing your opponent's face doesn't do anything. Using the revenge also doesn't do anything at this point, so kind of like the Gromash. It doesn't do much, but it's still a play that doesn't waste anything. On the other hand, I guess Bash is a card that is kind of a worse removal than Gromash. If you're planning to use Gromash for the purpose of removing your opponent's minion instead of dealing like the 10 damage to face or so. I guess Bash can be a better choice here.
Sure.
Another
temporary. I mean, very easily, like Gromash uses 4 damage and then Bash is 3. You're gaining that armor anyways. In this case, Gromash, for example, is much better. So now this demon has a couple of choices. You can play the Infested Tauren as well. Just kind of complicate the attacks from the Gorehowl if he gets to set anything behind it.
Yep, the Tauren seems like a fairly obvious play here. It's going to get dealt with quite easily, but it's just something that doesn't get wasted. Oh, there's a Justicar.
Okay. Maybe that's the... Is it too late, though? I mean, he's 30 armor behind his opponent.
It might be, but it does give him a little bit of hope here. At least the life totals are not going to get more and more in this demon's favor.
How high do you think this demon will get up?
I'm gonna say 100.
100?
Yeah.
I'll be the jerk on the Price is Right and say 99.
Wow. I mean, if there's with players had something like around 10 card remaining, so it's gonna get to 100 before we get to the monkey stages, I believe. Because he's already at what, like almost 90.
Yeah, I mean, you're right. He's getting really high up there. Greyjay still doesn't have much of a play. Doesn't want to replace his Gorehowl, so he's just going to use revenge. And these plays look rather really silly if you're new to Hearthstone, but the whole point is you're trying to not die to that fatigue damage, and you realistically will start seeing players draw to 9 to 10 damage fatigue in just about a couple hours from now.
A couple of hours. We'll see how long it takes, but here, I think now it's finally time for the Chrome. Like, there's no alternatives. You don't want a shield block. You don't want to play an Acolyte. And, like, there's obviously nothing to shield slam. Brawl also unavailable. It's like the only play he can do.
Yeah, and Greyjay has very easy removal, but he's also stuck similar in position as he was last turn, so I anticipate removal of this.
Yeah, he could also, like, steal it with the Sylvanas if he wanted to, but this is kind of an easy play. He also gets rid of 2 cards from his hand, which is a positive thing in this situation. So now he won't have to play anything if he doesn't want to for a couple of turns, or at least one turn.
Another Infested Tauren, allowing this demon to take it even slower.
Yeah,
it's a pretty important draw. I think at this point, though, for Greyjay, he wouldn't be upset about getting the monkey.
That seems to be the only way, in my eyes, that could. Give him a chance, but then again, like the Nozoth in this demon's hand, and also the Sylvanas. So if there was a monkey, this demon could just first play the Sylvanas and then go for an extremely powerful Nozoth, and it's very hard to deal with the random legendaries, even if they are good, when there's like a huge board from your opponent.
I'd like to get another card count here on the decks to see how many cards remaining. Because the real game, in my opinion, begins when there's 8 cards or less of these. And that's where you can start really managing things in, 4 cards. Are we here already? Wow, this road trip was much faster than I anticipated.
Yeah, this demon might have been roping a little bit with his rogue, but he has been playing a fair bit faster this time around. And I'm kind of happy about that.
And we're introduced with a hard choice already, you know? He doesn't exactly have the monkey to answer with Nozoth, because he knows if Nozoth gets played, then it gets brawled. Does he actually dig a little bit deeper into his deck?
No, he has to shield slam his own guy, I think.
Shield slam his
That's
own
2-2?
That's
the only thing he can do.
Oh my goodness. What kind of world has this come to?
He has to do it. I mean, you can't play the Sylvanas, you can't play the Nozoth. It's just, at least, I strongly believe that is the correct play in this situation.
I don't think it's the right play based off a morality point of view. Slime lives matter, Savitz. Oh,
summoning portal. I don't think somebody, that's going to be doing
imagine
much.
Imagine that with the monkey, though.
It's like Aviana.
Yeah, you can play. Oh, man. That is the wombo combo.
How does it work? Do you get? No, maybe it doesn't do anything.
I mean, every,
you can get the Aviana easier, though. So then you'll have like more mana available for the Aviana turn.
Right.
That'll work, but
I mean, you play that so you can play Aviana and a few other things, too.
Right.
At least our secret finally coming to hand for Dizdemon, so Greyjoy is very well aware of the next few turns. I think Dizdemon has two cards remaining in his hand, or three cards remaining in his deck. So in the next three turns or so, Greyjoy will be faced, will know that his opponent has everything.
Yeah, neither of these players have drawn any cards during this game, and both have added one with the Elise Starseeker, so the card counts, I believe, are exactly even at this point. Whether it is like three or four cards. I think it's like two or three cards, I think. We saw the card count there, which was like four, and yeah. So now after drawing that one, he's back to that because of the Elise.
Right. So
Fiery War Axe now.
Yeah, Fiery War Axe. Not necessarily bad to just equip if you just feel like Gorehow's value is done. It's already killed four things. Now it could probably kill a fifth.
Yeah. I mean, after that attack, it's going to be down to two attack anyway.
Ooh, he was just going to play Brawl. Yeah, you don't really get many times Brawl value.
Oh, yeah. I don't hate that.
Oh, Summoning Portal.
I wasn't really thinking about that as an option, but it seems fine to me.
Yeah, it's clever. I like it.
Yeah.
Does he want to attack this?
Yeah.
What if his opponent gets the monkey and then be able to... I guess he's okay with that, too.
I mean, if he leaves that up, I guess his second Brawl is more likely to have positive outcomes.
Yeah, that's also true. I remember back in the days when, in this matchup specifically, you just brawl with the moment your opponent plays with Dr. Gloom. That might be the best value you ever get.
Yeah.
Okay, Dizdemon still just waiting for Greyjoy to take action. Greyjoy still has no monkey in his hand.
Yeah.
He's still just nowhere to be found.
Really, like, I don't see how exactly Greyjoy is going to be able to pull this one off, because he will be the first one who has to get a monkey, but... Then again, Nozo is just waiting there. This demon drawing the map. How many cards? He has 10 cards right now, so I would expect to see the Fiery War Axe probably getting equipped here.
Okay, digging a little bit deeper.
Oh man, great draw.
Oh man, just equips the Fiery War Axe, gets the Gorehow out of the way. And what armor count are we at?
I believe we are at 92.
Oh man.
So just two more turns. We'll be there.
Last card! The 30th card being the Golden Monkey, and Greyjoy is not happy to see that.
Yeah, he could like shield block to just go for it right now, but it might be the map still, so he wouldn't even have mana, I believe, too.
Right.
Oh, he could if he skipped the tank up. He has the option here to maybe slam his own thing, or maybe revenge it. That doesn't really matter. Okay. So there goes that portal. We saw a shield slam from this demon on his own slime, and now we see a revenge from Greyjoy to remove his own portal.
Yeah, that's why no one likes Garrosh, man. He just kills anybody.
Yep.
Regardless of allegiance.
Wow, and
slam?
This is pretty bad for this demon.
What's wrong with these? Where's the monkey? The monkey is just he's calling in sick.
Last card for,
last
both,
card
players.
For both players.
Yeah.
I mean,
this demon looking at four cards that draw cards, four cards that cannot be played, and two cards that he needs to save for later.
Yeah, man.
It's
Golden Monkey is totally playing hooky. Shield slamming is also fun.
Yeah, that makes sense. Good strong play there, because like obviously otherwise Greyjoy would have been able to like donate the acolyte to this demon.
Oh man, what a ridiculous outcome! It instantly plays a map to the Golden Monkey. Yeah. That's right. Take those yoga pants off. You're coming into work.
He has to do it, but it's just he knows that Nozod is coming, and it's going to bring all four Death Rattle minions from this demon.
Oh, gross.
There you go.
Well, that's actually decent.
He's got the Morose Acid Maw combo.
Wow. What else is there? We have a Confessor, Pale Tress.
We have a Captain Greenskin on an actual weapon.
Two Gruels. I don't think that's going to be good enough, Rodan.
Yeah. There are cards that are pretty annoying to deal with. What can Confessor Pale just summon that could help him come back? Is there anything that we can think of?
I mean, Therion is usually pretty good.
Pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But this board that he's looking at right now, like, there's not really any card that would properly deal with it. Acid Mow, yeah, it can help remove some of it, but there's still going to be so much remaining after. So he's just going to go for, like, the Desperation. Beltress hope to pick up something that would be, like, spectacular, but I can't think of a minion that would save him. Oh!
Wait, what?
Ice Owl, of course, very powerful to attack minions, but yep. Can't really do much. You're going to hope that Sylvanas steals a 1-1.
Okay. It does,
so that could have been worse.
Yep.
And this demon has Brawl. He also can play Brawl on his own monkey afterwards. A lot of options. You can also just cleanly remove almost everything anyways without using Brawl and just play monkey for the fact that you can get an extra card.
Yeah,
extra legendary minion.
Just like he definitely wants to use the execute. There's no doubt about that. He will use the execute here. Could he save it for later? But in any case, like, he will not play the golden monkey before the execute has been used. I wouldn't mind just seeing it here, maybe going for his own golden monkey afterwards. Like, because after that, the hand is going to be pretty much dead. Like, it doesn't really do anything.
Yeah, precisely. So, this demon, let's see. Slamming.
Just okay.
Keep it as much board presence as you can. I like it.
Yeah. I mean, he does have that brawl, and he's in such a great spot right now that I wouldn't blame him for just, like, holding onto his monkey and just, like, letting his opponent try to make some kind of power play. And, like, Great Jay here, he needed 4 Tyrians or so. This is not it. Like, the 2 Gruels are in the Captain Greenskin. Not quite gonna cut it.
Yeah, just you can't play it all at the same time.
Yeah, I think we might just see a concede here. Like, none of these cards are any good.
Nah, I'm looking at it, and I completely agree. I think, you know, Greyjay is stuck in a really bad position. If he had empty board potential, like, Hogger's not bad, if he was able to present some of these threats.
Yeah.
But it's just not the case here, and this demon can continue to wear his opponent down.
Yeah, but it just has, like, a very easy trade to the board, too, for this.
Armor count, by the way, is at 95, which means that if he tanks up, he's at 99.
Oh,
and
man.
I believe that'd be one off of the armor prediction that you base.
Throw down.
Just want to say that I also said 99. Just
yeah.
Put it out there. Here we
okay.
Go. Golden Monkey time. And he gets
way
Emperor
better. That is
wow.
So much better than what the.
Arch Thief Rafam is also super nasty.
Yeah. Oh, Steve from Family, that is the MVP. There's even Medivh synergy. Like, he could play with a Medivh and then play the 10 mana spell from Archsteve.
Whoa!
Not that he really needs it in this situation, but still, like, kind of a huge synergy there.
Another Ghoul to join the party.
Yeah, Greyjay is probably at this point just thinking about what deck to queue up for the next game.
Yeah, also, you know, there's also a possibility his opponent has just very bad legendaries as well.
I suppose.
You know, like, Nat Bagels and Lorewalker Chose.
2 Bagels and maybe, like some. Like you said, something along those lines. Just like card draw minions.
Yeah, but that's probably going to spell the end of the line here. It's been a great journey. Hope you guys enjoyed this tour through Warrior Alley. But we're going to wrap it up really soon here because Greyjay can't really hold on with these quality minions coming down on him.
Yeah, it looked like it was this demon's game from a very early point already. I would have preferred if Greyjay kind of went for something a little bit more desperate there. But then again, if he goes for a strategy where he draws cards, this demon can just match that up and just stay like 2 cards behind. Maybe that does allow his opponent to be drawing more as well. So I don't really think there was a way out of this one for Greyjay besides an incredibly much stronger golden monkey than what his opponent got, which is not what happened.
Yeah, I do think that you're on to something, Savitz. I think if perhaps he understood that if he played this, you know, tit for tat game where, like, I'm trading 1 for 1, I'm just going to be really far behind, so I need to take that risk for the golden monkey earlier, but he didn't, and
yeah.
As a result, the expected result happened.
I mean, you saw it on his face when he realized that it's the last card in his deck. It was something that he needed earlier. Maybe
yeah.
Like fast, if he got a fast monkey and his opponent's Nozoth was somewhere at the bottom, maybe there was a chance, but
yeah.
It's the way it worked out. That was this demon's game.
So that's going to tie up the series 1-1. When we come back, we're going to have game number 3 in this best of 7.
What's your favorite Hearthstone deck right now?
Murloc Paladin.
Murloc Paladin?
Yeah.
Wow. Why Murloc Paladin?
Because it's a combo deck, no, with OTK, and not so slow like other combo decks. You can play in temp and then make your combo. Most part of games you can win just with playing your tempo cards, not with combo.
So you play usually on stream as well, really fast. Why do you play so fast?
Because when I'm nervous, I can overthink me and make wrong decision. And I think when I'm nervous, first decision is the best.
So you trust in your instincts?
No, I just count fast.
You can do math really fast?
Yeah.
If I gave you a bunch of math questions right now, could you
no.
do them really fast?
No.
No?
No, I'm not ready.
Okay. Would you consider yourself to be a risky player or a safe player in the game?
Sometimes it's better to be risky, sometimes it's better to be safe, but when it's equal, I prefer to be a safe player. It's better to do that I'm sure of instead of taking a risk.
I like this guy. Because TJ asks really hard math questions.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Yeah.
Yeah, Gray J is saying that he likes Murloc Paladin. He did get the win quickly with that in game one, but now he's going to have to find three more wins and with decks that he doesn't like quite as much.
All right. Well, one of them is the Warrior, which you can go back to. If you guys are just joining us, we had Control Warrior Mirror just recently and ended in Dizdemon's favor tying up the series. Now we have Druid Shaman Rogue up against Druid Warrior Hunter. Remember, Great J has that N'Zoth Hunter, which I'm looking forward to, because I haven't seen N'Zoth really play out in Hunter the way people have theorycrafted for months now. People always said, yeah, you know, there's a lot of death battles in Hunter. Why not just play N'Zoth in it?
Yeah, it's a little bit unfortunate situation for Great J, though, that because his opponent's Warrior is now has gotten its win, so he will not be able to match his Hunter against the Warrior, which would have been the optimal matchup for it.
All right, so let's go into a Druid versus Druid. The mirrors continue here. Likely the only mirror that's going to remain in this series. As we have the opening hands shape up, we do have that Innervate from Dizdemon, which can be really powerful to innervate that Mire Keeper to get that early ramp.
Yeah, both hands looking a tiny bit clunky right now, even for Dizdemon. Like if he goes for an Innervate Mire Keeper here, he doesn't have a follow-up with it just yet. So Wild Growth would be potentially a huge draw. Here,
Would you innervate now?
I don't think it does anything. I would probably just hero power, because next turn having 4 mana doesn't help you. I mean, he could be hoping to pick up something he can play later, but I wouldn't mind just hero powering now and maybe going for like an innervate Drake on turn 3, and then just go for the Mire Keeper on 4 and Emperor after that.
Yeah, it seems to be a much more clean use of the mana.
Okay.
Dizdemon says, you know what, I'm just going to ramp anyways, potentially pick up something better. Also have the board advantage, because 3-3 does answer these 1-1s.
The way I look at this is like, it's kind of a high-risk, high-reward play. If he finds something strong to play next, then maybe like a punch roll or any like a 4-mana play, it's going to be doing just fine. But as it is, like, he doesn't have anything, so... Yeah, so now that the... You know, right now, not doing that much, and what he ended up doing was just give Great Jay a strong turn two there over just hero powering phase.
It does feel a little bit sketchy, though, because of the fact that Dizdemon is playing the Maligos version versus Great Jay's playing the token version. So if Great Jay was making that play, he's playing to Violet Teacher, for example, to play on 4 to try to get on the board presence. Dizdemon had a high likelihood of just whiffing, which he just did.
I really didn't like that one bit there, just based on the fact that he didn't have a follow-up to it. Great Jay taking kind of a lead right now. He's going to have the Mire Keeper, so he will be at the 5 mana next turn. Dizdemon will get his first Drake on the board, but Great Jay already has trades for it, so he will be able to both play his own Drake and just trade off for his opponent's Drake.
The purpose of Innervate is to get yourself the tempo onto the board early, or to snowball into something. So maybe you like, you know, Innervate a Wrath or Innervate Swipe or something like that. And then Dizdemon passed with 2 mana remaining, or actually essentially 4. Yeah. So he just basically gave up the value that Innervate's supposed to help him snowball from there.
Yeah.
And that's the point of which you know, me and Sveets feel a little bit confused there. Maybe Deez Demon felt like if he was getting like Raven Idol, or if he got, like you said, Fandral, or perhaps another Mire Keeper. Those were the outs that he was playing.
Yeah, there were a bunch of cards that he could have drawn from the top that would have made that play be extremely good. Maybe even Wild Growth would have been fine. He got a Wild Growth hero power there. So it's not like strictly a mistake, but a little bit of like an unnecessary risk in my books. But here he has those two Drakes and the Norris. He could be considering the Norris here, but I would probably lean towards the Drake here. I wouldn't hate like nourishing for mana, I suppose, because the Drakes will be drawing some, but yeah, I think this is kind of the strongest play, because this early on in the game, having the 4-4 minion on the board is also quite significant. If he didn't, if he just went for the Norris there, he would have been facing a kind of a difficult board to deal with later on, and there would be a lot of like damage kind of stacking up over multiple turns.
How good is this Innervate card being drawn right now? Would you want to use it and skip the Ancient of War, but get, you know, keep some more minion presence on the board?
I don't know. Like I don't think like kind of the same situation as for this demon when he went for his Innervate. Like I don't see a strong follow up to this. If he went for the Innervate Power of the Wild, the giant would still be 7 mana next turn, so he would not be able to play it. So it would result in a weak turn. Yeah. For Greyjay on the following turn, so I really like just holding on to the Innervate for now.
Yeah, and not to mention that it's also a proper mana curve for the following turns. You Innervate out the Giant, which would be 8 mana, and then you play Ancient of War on 7 mana. Very strong back-to-back turns, and good planning here from Greyjay.
Yep, this demon going for an Ember, and that's quite a bit of value with it. Having those two Nourishes, also the Drake Wrath is something that gives him a great tempo potentially.
Yeah, and that's something you do want to kill. It has disrupted the plans from Greyjay, so mulching that, wouldn't blame him. Would you just play Power of the Wild as a 3-2 as well, just to add board pressure?
How does it line up with the Arcane Giant? Like, it might be helpful for him to just play a spell to reduce the mana cost on the Giant, so he could do that. I mean, yeah, it's kind of valuable to have the Power of the Wild later too, but he does have two.
Yeah, two gets a little clunky because you don't have the Violet Teachers or the Fandral in hand, and that's when having two gets absolutely crazy.
Yeah, I like the mulch here. Nothing else really seemed to make sense. If he went for Ancient of War or Arcane Giant, he would have been unable to deal with that Emperor, and that would have led into disaster. Another round of discounts for this demon with a huge hand. I wouldn't have seen much chance for Greyjay moving forward. Big Game Hunter. Wow, from the mulch. That might be very good.
Wait,
later on.
Yeah.
Just from the mulch, so that's actually really awesome. Like if you're this demon, you're like, oh well, that deals with an Arcane Giant.
What's really funny is that Druids used to play Big Game Hunter until Big Game Hunter was nerfed, and then it was replaced by mulch.
Yep.
So there's a lot of delicious irony in what just happened.
That's quite hilarious, I have to say.
Oh man, nourishing for cards, just trying to improve the quality of his hand. And
yeah.
Got some pretty good ones. Swiping Giant, if he can just continue to reduce the cost of that, will be really effective.
Yeah, that Emperor so good there. He is able to nourish and deal with that Drake now, and this demon's hand is just looking so great. Doesn't have anything on the board, and he has taken quite a bit of damage. He's down to 19 for now, with no healing inside, but still. Oh man, if he uproots. Well, I mean,
heavy uproots. Oh,
it's
man.
So huge. I mean, you wouldn't really want to do that because something like spell power swipe or swipe rod, it wouldn't be worth the risk.
I mean, I do want to call attention to that if Greyjay's been playing really defensive with Power of the Wilds, but and obviously we have the caster vision of like knowing what is in these demon's hands, but if he can be, you know, more aggressive with Power of the Wild, he's pushing all this damage.
Yeah.
And, you know, his opponent's at 19, threatening. It would have been an opportunity to see if he can push it.
It does kind of look like that Greyjay does have to make something happen very quickly because of the value that this demon has gotten from the Nourish. And now
goodness.
The second Nourish. But on the other hand, like, for Greyjay, just going for the Power to Wilds, that might not be a winning line of play, even though it would give him a little bit of pressure. So by holding under two Power to Wilds, something like a Violet Teacher would suddenly make the hand quite amazing.
Well, this got awkward really quickly. This demon drew nothing he could play for two mana besides it. And, okay.
Oh. Well, but that was such a weak turn there, though.
Yeah. I mean, Moonfire is in general a weak card. Only works well with Maligos. And in this case, Arcane Giant.
And he placed Arcane Giant. Oh, this demon just waiting with the Big Game Hunter. I don't think he's going to rope before he does that play. I mean, or maybe he does want to just kind of like consider all of his options before going for it, but it's going to happen.
All right. So we have a Big Game Hunter target, and then we could play. We have 5 mana remaining. We could play our own giant, or is there another option that we can explore?
Trying to see if there's like a I mean, he could hold under the big game. You know that your opponent is playing two Arcane Giants, so you don't necessarily have to big game hunt the first one, but it's such a huge like swing that it's hard to pass up.
It's also extremely demoralizing.
It really
to shut down Greyjay.
Oh man,
I've got the beast in my sight.
The reaction from Greyjay just says it all.
Oh my goodness.
Really? Like
that's a sound clip I haven't heard in a while. Hey, there you go. Paying off with the holding on the power of the wilds.
Oh yeah.
And that's a really strong board.
Yeah, and even if this aggression doesn't pay off, which it very well might, that is such a strong board right now. He still has the Yorkshire on to kind of like fall back on.
And, that's a really intimidating board.
It really is, but he does have two swipes, and now he also picked up a Rot, so there should be some kind of board clear, or at least close to a board clear available to him. They could like double swipe the Ancient of War. Then like make two trades, maybe Wrath for one. That would, for example, do it. Other options. There's probably a bunch of ways to do it, but he's at 12 HP, so I would expect him to go for the clear here. Probably saving the Feral Rage and the Moonclade, kind of like get back up next turn. He does not need to heal just yet, because this demon does know that Greyjay is not playing the Malukas version, but instead playing like this token variant. So 12 HP is something that he's certainly comfortable with. Did he Wrath for one?
Yeah, he Wrath for one one of the Panthers.
All right, I was just like looking. Did he draw a card? But yeah, he should.
Okay. So Drake. He has a swipe. Now he's starting to dump his hand. This is a strategy that you see a lot of people use with Yogg-Saron to use him as a refill and to address the board state. It also could just kill your opponent if he's at too low HP, but we know with inclusion of Moonglade Portals, two Feral Rages, it's unlikely that this demon will allow himself to be put in a really bad position.
Oh yeah, I would expect this to be a heal turn one way or another. Right. Starting with the Raven Idol seems fine.
Yeah. Can't pick up a lot of spells to help him. Speaking of heals.
I mean, he could use the healing touch for also healing, and then there's quite a few options here. I don't think he's going to pick the Nurries, because he already has so much cards in his hand, and even the Auctioneer, so it comes down to whether he wants to try to get a new one with the Raven Idol, or just go for the heal, but being down at 10 HP, even with the healing in his hand, it's kind of like picking the healing touch here allows him to use the Feral Rage offensively more easily.
Right. This demon, Moonglade Portaling first, see what minion he gets. Kidnapper.
Yep. There could be some arguments made in favor of like a... No, you can't get that. I was thinking of the Naga Sea Witch, but you can't get that one because you get six drops. So.
Yeah. Yep. Would have been nuts if that was the case.
Oh, yeah.
Raven Idol before the Yogg-Saron. Claw can also fit in as well.
Yeah, I think this is the time. I mean, Mire Keeper doesn't really do anything, so...
Soul of the Forest.
Pick the claw. Pick the claw. Play the inner raid and just play the claw, play the inner raid and just see what happens.
Spin the wheel.
Yeah, you could say so.
Yeah, let's see what happens with Yaga. His goals are going to be primarily just to make sure that he has board advantage and draw back some of the cards.
Yeah, both the Roar and the Soul of the Forest kind of suck here. He already played both of his Power of the Wilds and there's no sign of Teacher, so. So, like, with Teacher, Soul of the Forest can't find a lot of value, but this doesn't seem like the situation for it.
I see. So, Greyjay wants his opponent to load more onto the board before he plays his Yogg-Saron. Right now, he feels like there's too much chance for Yogg-Saron to die, and then, target himself after killing Kidnapper. Wants to have more of a swing.
Yep. And I would have probably personally just went for the Yogg there, but, I guess this is fine too. Now he might be able to like pick up something from the top, add more spells to it maybe. So not too bad. It's
going to be this demon
going for it.
Really? And he's choosing not to kill anything off first, so any combo effects are also reduced.
I don't know if he needed to do this. Like, he did have that healing though, so this seems a little bit maybe unnecessary to me, and there are bad results that could happen here.
Yeah. Contrary to popular opinion, there are capable things. Like, if he Astral Communions?
Yeah.
It didn't feel like he needed to do it. Okay, although that is a lot of damage. 12 from that Yogg-Saron. Imagine if he picks up Wind Fury of some kind.
Nice brawl.
And Yogg-Saron is defeated. Oh, second brawl.
Backstab. That's okay. Let's him like clean the. Not. Just not let him clean it up from the board.
All right. And is that it?
Yeah,
that was it.
That didn't really do anything at all.
Yeah.
Let's just return the Mire Keepers to the hand.
Why? Yogg-Saron's just not really having it.
Yeah, that ended up being terrible for this demon.
That was 10 mana sap your opponent's Mire Keeper.
Oh man, what? Yes, Krejci has a chance here to pick up a Power of the Wild that he could innervate after the teacher. So, Power of the Wild, certainly the card he's looking for here, does not get it.
Okay, but still he has the Innervate Wild Growth cycle, and his opponent used both swipes.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind just seeing that. Let's just pick another. But he played both of his own powers, so.
Right.
So he couldn't, like, pick up another one, but it is a lot of 1/1s. But I probably like the better choice. I mean, you're never picking the Claw here, right?
No, I would say rather Innervate.
Yeah.
Depending on what you're looking for. Now, he does know that this demon played Raven Idol.
He could double Innervate the Mire Keeper here. That's probably, like, the maximum pressure that he could do. So I wouldn't hate that. Because the swipes are gone, so you could have gotten like 2 1/1s, get a 3/3 and a 2/2. Could have been okay.
Yeah, could have been fine as well. I actually don't really hate anything that he chooses here, really. Whether or not he plays a Mire Keeper or chooses to play it a little bit conservatively with the Wild Growth instead.
Yeah, I guess that's okay. The Innervate ended up being like just spawn a 1/1 and get a hero power to his opponent's face.
I'm trying to think, like, how much damage. I think because he's generated 2 extra tokens from that Wild Growth as opposed to the Mire Keeper generating 5 power, that would have been 3 damage lost. And right now he has 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 power. That actually would be the difference maker, assuming that he'd be able to attack with everything and all of his minions survive.
Yeah, I think I would prefer the Mire Keeper there, but yeah, might work out still. Like, if there was some kind of board clear, maybe like Raven Idol swipe or something, so then he has a better chance to kind of recover with the Mire Keeper and the Moonglade portal that he ended up picking up from the Wild Growth.
No, that's a good point. Both portals were, or both Raven Idols were used, and he still hasn't seen what it was. So he wasn't sure if Starfall might have also come to the hand.
Yep.
He sees Starfire able to remove his Violet Teacher. This demon also has that healing touch to buy some time.
Yeah.
A little bit awkward.
Seemed like he was considering taking an aggressive approach here, but he does not have the Malygos just yet, so.
Wow.
Ooh. He's playing with fire!
He's
so weak, he's such low HP.
Reckless Rocketeer would be lethal.
Oh, man. Don't even say that, Savitz. That would be just like a heartbreaking way to end the game here for this demon.
Oh, man.
Okay.
But if he makes the attack first, he wants to maximize the heal here. But now if he got the Rocketeer, it would actually no longer be lethal. It would be one damage off.
Ancient Harbinger. Now, that card would usually bring you a Yogg-Saron, but it's unfortunately already in the hand for Greyjay. Very fun card when you get out from the portal.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. This demon's out of cards.
Wait a minute.
So Gadgetzan's like a real big liability. He might actually doesn't have any more resources. Greyjay fatigues his opponent out.
Wait a minute. Oh, the Malygos. He played the Yogg, right? And was there like a tracking in it? Wait, how am I? I'm a little bit lost right now.
Yeah.
Or does he just not play Malygos?
I didn't think he had that. I was waiting for Malygos to come to his hand.
Yeah,
that was
too.
Very interesting.
He plays double Moonfire. There has to be a Malygos.
No, there is a Malygos in the deck.
So it was like a tracking from the.
Was it?
It did pull
something really fast, I think. And the card was face down based off the. Experience. Me and Savitz are going to talk about it, and we'll let you guys know. In the meantime, we're going to be right back right after this, guys.
So, what kind of stuff do you like to do besides play Hearthstone? Do you have any hobbies?
Table tennis and football.
Table tennis?
Yeah. I've played France Nationals.
Oh, wow.
A long time ago.
A long time ago? How old were you when you competed in that?
I was 16, something like that.
Do you still play a lot? Do you have a...
Yeah, I play at home for fun.
Who do you play against usually?
My brother or my father.
Are they really good too?
Yeah.
Did your father teach you from a young age?
Yes.
So is your family supportive of what you do in Hearthstone? Do they support you playing all the time and trying to be competitive?
Yes, support me. I think it helps you a lot. It's just better to have someone which is supporting you in addition to your teammates or your friends. They know the game and they like it.
Oh, they play Hearthstone as well?
Yeah.
Do you ever give your dad false tips?
Yeah.
Troll your dad?
Welcome back, everybody, to the third quarterfinal of the day between Dizdemon, who apparently burned his Malygos and one of his Arcane Giants, we think, during the Yogg-Saron process. With the tracking, must have discarded it.
That must have been it. Like, that Malygos was missing, and Dizdemon also there, probably wondering where his dragon is at. Like, so unfortunate. But we were talking about it at the moment he played the Yogg-Saron, that it might have been a little bit unnecessary. Like, he was doing just fine in the game. That Yogg eventually did end up costing him the game. I believe that with that Malygos, his chances to win would have been extremely high, if not even like a guaranteed win.
Yeah, there's two things there. First, his opponent had a Mire Keeper on board, and he had removal. He had Living Roots. Yeah. I mean, he could have used Moonfires there to remove as well and just kind of play it safe until his Giants or Malygos came in the hand. The second thing is, the second Yogg-Saron gets a lot better than the first one, because then you can use it to try to answer your opponent's board that he used to create. So, you know, when you're in that much of a position, you know, if you're not threat of dying, maybe you just play passive Healing Touch yourself, you know, take a little bit slow, and then Yogg-Saron back.
Yeah, so maybe a little bit unfortunate, but also maybe it could have been avoided if he played it a little bit different. But here we go into the next game, and Dizdemon is going to be playing his Malygos Druid and trying to not discard it this time. Rayjay is going to be piloting his Control Warrior with that Yogg-Saron as well.
That's right. Even warriors are getting in on the party in Karazhan. The Yogg-Saron party, of course.
Yep, and Rayjay with that Fire War Axe, so if there is an early Mire Keeper, which looks like it might just happen here, he will have an easy way to deal with it.
Now, would you save this Innervate coin for the Emperor Thoris in the following turn?
No, I would probably maybe went for like an Innervate Mire Keeper for mana, then
can coin Nourish.
Yeah, I guess it's fine to also hold on to it, like just get greedy. He does play an Auctioneer in his list, so. Yeah, I guess it's okay. Like, he can take it slow. There is that Fiery War Axe, so the Mire Keeper would have just died on the board.
Okay.
Can't blame him with this.
Yeah, taking it really slow.
Yeah, this lines up pretty well with that Nourish before the Emperor too, so he will be able to first fill his hand and then get the sweet, sweet Emperor discount on all of those cards.
Yeah, Grady is not wasting time anymore. He's just instantly playing his Lee Starseeker and just trying to get Dizdemon and corner him. The Druid versus the Control Warrior matchup generally does favor the Control Warrior pretty significantly, as long as they understand the win conditions and how to play their strategies effectively. Primarily making sure that, one, they always control the board away from Druid, because Druids, when they're not playing the token strategies, are not actually very board-centric. They're very passive and drawing a ton of cards and trying to combo their opponents in this matchup.
Yeah, that is true. I actually talked with Dizdemon about this particular matchup yesterday, and I was wondering if there's enough damage to maybe kill the opponent with the Malygos list, but Dizdemon said that get just an Auctioneer is one of the key cards, and most important thing to do is to just try to get through your deck as quickly as possible. Just draw many cards and try to kind of like overwhelm the warrior before they draw into all of the removal.
Right. You know, for lack of a better comparison, it does function very similar to how Miracle Rogue lines up against Control Warrior.
Yep.
You have a couple of significant big threats that can come and pressure the opponent, but you just want to draw a lot faster and basically make Warrior have the right resources at the right time, which won't always happen, or even outvalue them because you're drawing so much.
Yeah, sometimes the Rogues can also like pick up aggressive early lines with maybe like Gold Plus and Floods and Conceals against Warrior, but just getting those powerful cycle turns, it is a huge deal. Great J finding a Justicar True Heart.
Yeah, it's huge.
It is. Some players even, I think it might have been Dizdemon who said it, but in this matchup, the Justicar True Heart might even be a starting hand keep card, which a little bit puzzles me. Like, you kind of still want to be curving out okay, so I think it feels a little bit risky. But against the Malygos Druid, like, it's a great card to have, and getting those early tank ups, they really do add up.
Yeah, I wouldn't hate it. Azure Drake to draw. Could also cycle the Wrath to try and, you know, dig deeper into his deck, but also remove the least with the Living Roots.
Yeah. A few options here. He could also, could he like innervate the second Drake and go like Moonfire?
Okay.
Moonfire Living Roots, if he doesn't want to save those. Like, there's a few options.
Yep, that's also a possibility as well.
There would be like a fair bit of pressure, but he might also want to be like holding on to those for now, and that's the really getting the cycle that he said that he values very highly in this matchup.
Well, he didn't value it highly enough to part ways with Living Roots.
Nope, looks like it. He does have more ways to draw, like Azure Drake is going to draw, and second Rod might also be drawing. There's still a second Nourish somewhere in the deck as well.
Yeah, and it makes sense too, given that when you have things like one mana Wrath and zero mana Living Roots, that's a lot of burst that comes from Malygos.
Yeah.
You might need that to win the game.
Yeah. And well, you kind of still need it quickly because, like, you know, Warrior can get all those armor effects from multiple different sources, like Shield Block, and not just the Hero Power, also Iron Forge Portal, Bash. So, like, Moonfire Living Roots with the Malygos as a win condition is a little bit like less reliable unless you get a good amount of minion damage in early on as well.
That's why I really like this Druid deck these days, the Malygos Druid. I know a lot of people are up in arms about the results based off how Yogg-Saron's outcome happens, but if you look at the 29 other cards of the deck, it's actually a very elaborate deck that has a lot of complex interactions with whether or not it's, you know, very defensive and has to play the removal game, or very fast and draw, or, you know, do you use Malygos for the burst finish, or do you just use it for removal versus stalling and other ways to win the game? I love the deck.
Yeah, I'm with you on that one. Like, Yogg-Saron might sometimes like make that deck look a little bit like a straightforward type of thing, like you play the Yogg, but that, I don't think that's the case at all. Like, it's a very difficult deck to pilot properly as well. Like, this is just so many like small decisions. What do you innervate out? When do you play your like threats? And how greedy do you get?
So, this demon, awkward position, you know. How does he part ways with some of his removal here to kill off this Grom?
Like, he's going to go for a Mandrill and just face tank that. That then he does get the 8 armor, so. It should be completely fine. He is up against the Control Warrior, and he does know that there isn't really any burst, so
ouch.
Just face tanking that, it's fine.
Yeah, I guess it's fine because Warrior's still not really bursting outside of that Grommish. The only other source of burst, in quotation marks, is Gorehowl.
Yep. The first giant comes down. Just gonna go for the Brawl here. Wow, yeah, Great Jay knows that this demon is not playing the token version, so... Oh no! It's the worst result. It was a 50-50, and it was the risk that he chose to take, and now he kind of has to pay the price.
Yeah, nice. You can Shield Block, Shield Slam, and remove the giant, but it is very costly.
It really is. That hurts, knowing that your opponent has a lot of burst damage potentially later. There he is, has to face tank that 8. Maybe would have been. Oh yeah, his base just says it all. He's not happy with how that turn played out. Whether he was unhappy with the Brawl result or the decision to go for the Brawl, that we can't know.
Yeah, especially when he got a second Shield Block as well. Yeah, so I think what he's thinking about is what he could have done: Shield Block into the Shield Block, clean removals and stuff. Either way, you know, this demon gonna continue to get the pressure on by drawing a lot of cards. Now the second giant,
yeah,
can cycle Wild Growth, make that zero mana. And that's one of the powers of our King Giants here, and that's why people consider it one of the most powerful cards in Karazhan.
So far, this game has been going exactly like this demon described that he would want it to be going. It's just perfectly so far. He gets that Auctioneer. There's a lot of potential to draw with it next turn. With the Wild Growth, for example, just for one mana, he will be able to draw two additional cards with the Auctioneer. Just gonna go for the swipe here. Figures out that he won't need it for later on. Discounts the Giants, also make some room for the cards, so he won't struggle with having too many cards after the Auctioneer is done with all the drawing action.
I like it. I like it a lot. Making sure you can just dig through your deck, like you mentioned. Acolyte of Pain. Just drawing cards, too, because Greyjoy needs to find a way to deal with this. Execute Judy the best way. I was originally looking at Sylvanas being played, but he just chose to draw cards very fast.
I wouldn't hate that. He seemed to be going once again for like more like a high risk, high reward player there. I would have preferred the Sylvanas too. Like, there was a fair chance that he finds something else than an execute. And now it's just like, he would much rather have the Sylvanas than the 1-1 and the 2-2.
Alright, so the cycle games continue here. Yogg-Saron coming to the hand for both these players.
Oh man.
Another Wild Growth. Does he need to draw more cards?
He actually has to be careful now with his hand size.
Yeah, he has 4-9 cards, I believe, and Wild Growth plus the cycle draws 3 cards.
Yep.
He could also play one Wild Growth and just hold on to the excess mana and not choose to play it. You can just like play...
Still too many cards, right?
Yeah, if he plays Raven Idol, I think he has too many cards now, too.
Yeah, like that's another spell. I think he's overdrawing no matter what here. So that was kind of awkward, to be honest. Well, maybe it won't matter. That's the leaving route, so he's going back to 10 card.
Burns Malygos, it really will matter.
It might, but I mean, there's so much power still in with that, like Swipe and Feral Rage. The Moonfires, however, will be... The Moonfires will be terrible after Malygos gets burned, but that'll be the second time in this match that Malygos does not end up in his hand.
Oh, man. Imagine if that's the case.
Yeah. that'd be painful, but once again, it would be kind of like self-inflicted. And
here we go.
Here we go. It's the Yorkshireon from Grey Jay.
Okay. The end turn button is not green, so you can attack.
It's like maybe one of the Hounds is alive. It's not going to be all that many spells, but it's going to buff his opponent. Where does Gone Cold go?
Oh.
And the Hero Bar gets replaced. Well, I think we're done here.
Well. High chance to do something impactful. Bane of Doom kills Summon Demon!
Yeah.
Oh, Malygos! I told you! Alright, well, I think he's just... Does he have lethal?
That is... the Moonfire is leaving Earth. That's four... Another four from the Feral Rage.
Yeah.
Four from the Swipe. So, yeah, this is going to do it. So, this Demon, even without this Malygos, is going to be able to take this one.
What if in some weird world he was taking too much fatigue damage also? Like, imagine if he didn't have that much health. Yes. He's taking all this fatigue damage. He would have to play... two more spells. That's significant damage.
That's actually...
This game was a lot closer than I thought it was.
Wait, what?
Wait. Okay. Alright, we'll, okay, he's dead.
Yep.
So, looks like, the demon was calling for an ammo, but looks like nothing is the issue at all whatsoever.
Yep.
So there you go. Game four is in the books, and it's back and forth in this series. Here we go. I hope you guys have been enjoying it so far. When we come back, game number five, to see who takes the series lead right after this.
What do you like to do besides play Hearthstone?
I'm studying program engineering.
Why did you decide to study that?
It's fun to count, to work with numbers, and it's interesting.
What made you start sort of getting into math and numbers?
School. I had pretty good teacher of math because when you calculate the same math problems, you always get to the same results.
Is that why you like Hearthstone? Because there's a lot of math and numbers?
Yes, but I like Hearthstone more because it's a game when you can do everything yourself. You don't need to play with team. If you lose, you know why did you lose. You don't need to depend on any people's.
Welcome back, everybody. Game number five about to begin between Diz Demon and Greyjay. You heard a little bit about Greyjay and how his, he has a love for numbers, apparently. Yep. my number that I'm thinking about is two. That is how many times Malygos apparently has been burned in this series by Diz Demon. And imagine if he lost that game, Savitz.
That's quite amazing. But I mean, I think that in the end, like, this series will be kind of decided on whoever, like, handles the pressure better. I feel like on both sides, like, this demon going for the Yogg when he didn't need it, which ended up, like, resulting in the tracking burning the Yogg, and then overdrawing there. I do believe that could have been avoided. Maybe casting one of the spells or, like, earlier, skipping, like, a second Wild Growth at the end and giving him the full hand. I really think that... whoever gets themselves together better is going to take it.
Yeah, I do feel like the series could have been improved on both sides. One of them, of course, I was asking Savitz in the break, is like, you know, why didn't he play Sylvanas against a giant when he had a chance to?
Yeah, that was really strange. Like, just going for the Acolyte and going for the revenge there against that giant. Like, Sylvanas seems like completely fine play to me. And just going for that play, the only way it would work out better is if he picked up exactly Execute.
Right.
Like, Execute was the only one, and there were still so many cards left in his deck that it seemed like extremely desperate play, and maybe it was a little bit early for that.
Yeah, all right. Well, I hope you guys have been enjoying this series. I believe we took a little bit of a bathroom break for Dizdemon, as some of these matches did go pretty intense, that Control Warrior Mirror, for example. But just to remind you guys about what they're playing for, and the fact that these guys are smack dab in the middle of best of seven. It's single elimination best of seven, so whoever wins this moves on to day two. But if you lose, your run ends here. And remember, we're giving out one more spot for BlizzCon before last calls, which is I'm excited for to find out who's going to win this tournament, but also for last call tournament. It's going to be really great.
Absolutely. In this series so far, we've seen Warrior versus Warrior, we've seen Druid versus Druid, but no more mirror matches possible. Both players now with different classes remaining.
Great J looks so tilted and stressed,
yeah,
man.
It does.
This is when a boy becomes a man. In the face of the fire that is the best of seven single elimination format right now here, Greyjoy is being put to the test mentally.
Yeah.
For his sake, I hope he can continue to pull through. Let's go into game number five, Rogue versus Warrior. Now, this matchup is a little bit different than usual because of all the spells that Warrior has to deal with some of those early game threats. I don't think it's as easy for Rogue to snowball, considering that this Warrior has a lot of early game tools.
Yeah. And the Rogue is quite all right in this, but look at Greyjoy starting. Like, if you're the Warrior player, it doesn't get much better than that. I don't even... What can you hope for more?
Not really much. I mean, maybe Blood to Ichor, or like if you really want to kill off something.
Yeah, like execute in case there's an early Edwin one cleave, but it does look quite amazing. Having the Fire War Axe and even the card draw from the Acolyte shield block, not too bad either. This demon is going to have to make something happen.
In the meantime, this demon once again playing the Rogue without the coin. It just feels like...
Wait, all right. He's thinking a very aggressive line here, it looks like.
Is there some kind of plot twist where we find out this demon was Dennis all along, who played against Crypt like 3 years ago in the beta?
Oh, man. He knows what he needs to do to win this one. And he's going to play this extremely fast. Like, that just sets the pace for the entire match. Like, we know what's coming. It's pretty tough to be switching it up from here now.
I love it. Establish dominance, Savitz.
Yeah.
To the face.
I mean,
that's great.
It was a little bit surprising.
I mean, if it works out for him and he's able to get that damage, the whole point is that he didn't really have much to do on that turn anyways. And he's thinking, well, my opponent is not playing a minion-based deck.
Yeah.
The only Shatter Strike value I really can get is on Starseeker or Sylvanas, assuming I don't have a board, maybe an Ironforge Portal minion. I'm going to be trying to rush him down before he can get to the point of no return, of just having too much removal.
Yeah, like, honestly, I don't feel like it was a bad play. It just caught me really off guard there.
It was so fast, too, because he's playing really slow and roping very often. Comes back from the bathroom, you know, kind of pulls up the pants. It's like, all right, I'm ready to go. And there's Shadow Strikes to phase immediately on turn three.
Yeah, I mean, there's not going to be any Violet Teachers or Fun Draws or anything like that coming out from the Warrior, so might as well, right?
Yeah. If it works out for him, man, he's a genius. I love it.
Indeed. Bash getting picked up. That goes pretty well with the slam, if he wants to do so. Being able to deal with that Tomb Pillager and seeing that aggressive... he's going to use the weapon. I was going to say that after seeing that aggressive Shadow Strike, I'm a little bit surprised that he actually chooses to use his hero here instead of the bash. He does have two bashes as well.
Yeah, another shield block, so potentially his life count is still safe.
But, I mean, with two bashes, he could have avoided taking that extra five.
Yeah, it does feel like that was an option for sure.
Alright, but this demon did not pick up an auctioneer. That would have been the best possible draw for him here. He did have that coin and the conceal ready, also a preparation, but he does get only an Assage. And I think the situations like this is where you can really tell like how good a player is. It's not when you get good cards when you're like a good player, no. It's when you get some kind of like mediocre hands or a little bit like awkward hands. Like, how do you like give yourself the best chance to kind of like get out of a troublesome situation. I would expect this demon to go extremely aggressive and take some big risks here.
And using the conceal here to make sure that he can get that questing adventure damage in. And very eloquently put, it's not about playing the good hands, it's about playing the bad ones. And this demon doesn't have the greatest hand to attack his opponent, but let's see how much he can make of it. He's got a pretty aggressive follow-up with Cold Bloods and the South Sea deckhand. Great J, no Ooh. Brawl. And that Sylvanas is so scary because you know that Rogue can just sap it.
Yeah, I really would not have liked to see that Sylvanas there. It's such a high-risk play because of the sap that you mentioned. And the decision to face tank the two abilities are also, like, it just puts him his life total at a dangerously low level, considering how much power is already on the board and how much more can the adventure potentially be doing.
Oh!
Well, there's the auctioneer for next turn. So if this aggressive play does not work out, there's still a chance for this demon to kind of like recover with that auctioneer.
Okay. Well, how would you choose to go about this? You don't want to use a cold blood.
Yeah.
It's the only spell to really cycle with auctioneer.
Looks like he's a little bit like switching gears here and not gonna cold blood and go aggressive anymore because of that auctioneer pickup. Because it does give him like kind of like an additional way to potentially win the game.
Makes sense to me. Now, GreatJ gonna remove this this board as efficiently as he can here.
Yeah, it's actually pretty good. Having two bashes here, not too bad. He did have like a slam too, so and maybe like Ravaging Ghoul. There were a lot of things he could have done, but yeah, that's a great turn, GreatJ. And this demon really looking for his second conceal for that auctioneer.
Yeah, if you can find a second conceal, he can get that cold blood damage in twice. Two preparations.
Wow. So if he, with the first preparation, if he picks up something like a fan of knives, that could open up a lot of other opportunities for him.
Okay. Attaching cold blood.
there we go.
Get the damage in if you can pick up something else to protect a second conceal.
That is the draw, but now sequence it carefully. You want to first probably attack. Like, I mean, he could pick up a second cold blood, but you probably want to conceal that deck hand. So if he conceals first here, might not work out that well. He could also consider like just eviscerating his opponent's face, but
he's counting his damage. 6, 10, 11 this turn, plus, assuming it survives. We know that, of course, the Ravaging Ghoul prevents it from surviving. But he's just counting just in case.
That conceal right there was such a huge draw.
There it is. Needs to find just a little bit more damage. Second eviscerate.
Great J does have a Ravaging Ghoul in his hand, so he can take out that salty deckhand, but there is no way to deal with the auctioneer right now.
No.
And can't really get much armor either, so.
Yeah, and that's the point of struggle for some of these control decks, and that's where Rogue punishes the hardest. And that's the strategy that this demon came in. He banned Shaman, very well aware that that deck is extremely powerful against Rogue.
Yeah, this demon right now looking for, I believe, is it. Two additional points of damage. Eviscerate with that auctioneer would be 8 damage. Another hero power attack would be additional 1. So he's 2 damage off right now. He does have one more cold blood in the deck. I'm not sure if there's another deadly poison maybe there.
Yeah, it could be. He's going for eviscerate to the face. Gets a cold blood.
And there it is.
And there it is. And you mentioned from the beginning of this game that it's going to be a little bit awkward for Dizdemon. But hey. Who Shadow Strike the face the very beginning?
Yeah, it ended up working so well. Like, when would he have even used that Shadow Strike? I think that's awesome.
Yeah, because the Shadow Strike would have, I mean, probably on like an Elite Starseeker mid-game, but it would have made his plays awkward. And remember, he couldn't get that 5 damage in elsewhere after he hit the face for the first time.
Yeah.
So, you know, a very fast decision on turn 3 ends up working out in the favor of Dizdemon, and I am very impressed by that Rogue win.
Yeah, that was so well played by this demon. He did get some good draws from the top. In particular, the second conceal was great. Having those double preparations for the auctioneer, but he really like maximized his chances of winning that one. And the plays that he chose to do really paid off. And now he's one game away from advancing to the semifinals.
All right, score is 3-2. Can this demon take game 6 and go to semifinals? We'll find out right after this. Don't go. Five games in, we have one player who is at the finish line, just needs to get over the final hump here. Dizdemon is up 3-2. Savitz's horse looking pretty prime and ready to go. He has to win one more with Shaman, and people put that as the best deck currently in the game.
Yeah, after that last game by Dizdemon, I'm really proud of my pick. And now he has two chances to win this one. He's going to be playing with his aggro Shaman, or playing his aggro Shaman right now, and going up against the two decks from Great J, one of them being the N'Zoth Hunter. And
I just want him to play that right now. Just get out of the way. You know?
Yeah, I really want to see it as well. I mean, there are, I believe, some explosive traps in there to kind of like counter some aggro. Yeah, he does play two explosive traps, so So those are cards that he teched in with Shaman in particular in mind. But
let's go.
It's still so slow.
We have the Nuzoth Hunter. Greyjay doesn't have a turn one play, looking for that fiery bat.
Yeah.
Very important to have that start against the Shaman deck. It's interesting because I've seen a lot of players also experiment with death rattle aspects of Hunter. For example, I think just last week, I want to even say that it was one of our finalists. I think maybe it was Teray, but one of them had Prince's Hooveron in their Hunter deck as well, and they got really far with that.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a fine card, and there's like kind of an obvious gap at 5 mana for Hunter players. Nothing seems to fit too well, so I can imagine Hooveron being an alright pick, kind of to make the curve a little bit better and not just go from Infested Wolf directly to the high main.
Which is what Greyjay's decklist is. There's no 5-mana minion. There's no 7-mana minion. It goes Infested Wolf, Savannah High Main, Call of the Wild, then Nuzoth. 2x2 they go.
And that's the same for a lot of players. Some players were decked in some or had decked in something like a like one copy of the minion that gives your beasts charge and Stampeding Kodo used to be a thing at some point, but we haven't been seeing any Stampeding Kodos in Hunters in recent days.
Oh,
that is such a huge deal right there.
There you go.
That's what the Hunter needs. It's a hover too. Wow, those were some fast turns of events. I was like looking at this demon's stall. Oh, that's pretty good, but Greyjay there getting that trade with his 2-drop with the Dotem Golem. Yeah. And now, wow, it's just...
This was super impactful.
Better better.
Yeah. The fact that it's not even necessarily that Hunter's ahead. That, I mean, it is important, but I think the really big important thing too, by the way, Maelstrom Boredom, very, very
helpful.
Effectful,
yep.
Is that the fact that he's just not falling too far behind early on. Because we know Hunter's late game is pretty crazy. You know, he's got 2 Call of the Wilds, he's got Nuzoth, and Savannah High Mains. But, you know, Shaman will eventually win the board early on. You just have to make sure not to lose too hard.
Quite often, yeah. And then Greyjay does play those 2 Unleash the Hounds that could potentially kind of like swing the game back. But yeah, a good Barnes there. There are a lot of Death Rattle minions, so it's not like Greyjay got extremely lucky here. And the chance to pick up something with the impactful Death Rattle are extremely high for the Hunter.
All right, well now turn 5, usually you see the Hunter, He has the Hunter Hero Power. The Shamans really lean towards playing Doomhammer to get it out early to help control the board, put some pressure on. He has 2 of them too in the hand. But he also is a little bit clunky mana-wise for the next few turns, especially considering that his board is behind as well.
Yeah, it's pretty tempting to be playing a Doomhammer here. Like, getting value out of both Doomhammers is nearly impossible. He's going to choose to go with the Flame Red and Faceless here. He knows that he still needs to deal a lot of damage to his opponent. His opponent is at 29 at this point, so just the Doomhammers would not be enough to kind of like get the job done. And goes for the 7-7. It looks like the 7-7 is going to potentially connect to a face here.
Yeah. It allows him to be aggressive right back.
Yep.
The demon picks up the thing from below and can reduce it to as cheap as 3 if he plays his other totems. And now the demon also has to consider things like, you know, what secret was being played, but he knows that it's explosive trap because he knows the deck lists.
Yeah, the deck lists are public, so this demon well aware that that trap is exactly explosive trap, and it might be a consideration not to be giving his... he has to be trading with the 7-7, but... Okay. 7-7 trades, because he didn't want to go face with the 7-7, and he didn't want his other minions to get the damage.
That's a lot of damage to be missing.
That's just a... okay. Alright, that's a lot of damage. And that Greyjay... Only looking at the Unleash the Hound and
The reason why it's weird is because you know that it's explosive trap, so why not at least have the 1-2 trade into the Barnes to at least give you a little bit of damage on that minion?
I mean, this way he does keep his Flame Tongue at full HP, so there's that, but it's worth it? I'm not sure. Might be.
Okay. Yeah, that also makes sense if you want to keep the Flame Tongue a little bit higher HP.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the 1 damage to the Barnes wouldn't have mattered all that much. But here, I would believe that we are going to see some trades happening at least for that 3-2.
Sure, that also is probably the best thing to do here in this situation. Hunter's been the more aggressive opponent here.
Yeah, and Greyjay winning the race really big time right now. Does have that bow and has that explosive trap up. Even though Nuzoth is not for this matchup, and it is in his hand kind of like being a dead card. It's just a the way that the early turns lined up really like put Great Jay in a good position.
So this demon, does he need to play the taunt here?
Oh yeah, I do think so. Just playing the Doomhammer, like, can you win the race? I don't know. I think that I'm kind of going for like more defensive play here with the thing from below. It might give him a tiny bit better chance, but it certainly is a tough position to be at.
If you play Doomhammer, you can get 8 damage over 2 turns, plus the hero power and the lava burst the following turn.
Yeah.
And that's only 10, 15 damage. Unfortunately, it's not enough. You'd be short 5. So that's definitely not a viable line to play here for this demon.
Yeah, we do have the caster side here, so we know that the Great Jay doesn't have like a reliable way to deal with that taunt right now. But this demon is kind of going to get rewarded for having that. And now the 9-1 Flame Raider Basis is actually going to get a good trade.
Yeah.
He found good value from it. A little bit maybe unfortunate for Great Jay to be picking up the Misha in this situation, but it is 1 out of 3, and the first animal companion that he played was very favorable for him in form of the Huffer.
All right, well, Greyjay is definitely a ways away from killing his opponent, while this demon is looking for ways to be aggressive right back.
Yeah, it's
I want to see if he can set up a Doomhammer this turn, because Tuskar Totemic has a high chance of doing nothing as well. The only way you can is if it gets like maybe like healing totems or Totem Golem itself.
Yeah, the Flame Raider trading for the 4-4 seems like the obvious play here, but the rest of this is a little bit of a mess because of the way that the board is set up with that explosive chop. So he's going to push the 5 damage here. Mm.
So you think he used a Doomhammer
to
clean up or to go face?
I think that he might just go face here and hope for the best. I wouldn't blame him for trading for the 3-2, because the 3-2 is offering a trade right now for the 5-3, and the next draw better be a good one for Greyjay, because this demon does have that Lava Burst ready and waiting.
Oh,
get to kill command!
Is that enough? I think it might be just enough here. Exact.
Wow.
All right, so that's going to wrap up the game here, and I think the consequence was about the same either way here, because he had the both beasts on the board. Unless he killed both beasts, right?
Oh, such a close game there.
Wow. And we have ourselves a game number 7, Savitz.
Yeah, we do.
It's coming down to the wire. The winner goes on to day number 2 to face off in the semifinals and keep their BlizzCon dreams alive. When we come back, the final game and conclusion of this best of 7. All right, we're going to game number 7. Determine it all. Who is going to keep their dream alive for the Hearthstone Championship Tour World Championships? Now, we go into game number 7 with the Shaman versus Warrior. Now, what do you think about this Warrior up against the aggressive Shaman? Remember, this is the spell-heavy Yogg-Saron Warrior.
It really is. I don't think the Yogg-Saron is going to help so much, because it's an expensive card, so that is not exactly what he would like to have in this situation. But he does have a lot of tools to deal with that. The spell-heavy version with the double Blood to Icarus, with the double Revenge. There's so many spells, so many removal that I do think that Greyjay is going to be a favorite going into this one. Quite heavily, actually, because there's also double Ironforge Portal. He's just like every single armoring card possible besides Armor Smith.
Probably just type spell into the search bar and just put everything in there that's not Rampage and Charge.
Yeah. So much stuff, but Greyjay does not find a Fire War Axe. That's one of the more important cards to have in the early game to kind of like prevent the board from snowballing too badly. This demon does have a turn 1, but no turn 2. Oh no! Okay, I actually have something I want to tell you about the Lightning Storm. That was the one card that this demon mentioned to me was something that he regretted having from in his decks, because he was predicting more aggressive lineups, and if that Lightning Storm ends up being dead, it might just get him knocked out.
Yeah, well, I mean, he does have plays for this turn, but the next turn's a little bit awkward, and perhaps if you replace Lightning Storm with, you know, Flame Juggler, that could have been a little bit better, or it depends on what he else wanted to do and include into his deck list.
But certainly not optimal in this matchup. Greyjay with that great Blood Swiker start. It's going to have a slam and a clean trade for that Totem Column that can oftentimes be very tricky to deal with.
Oh, yikes. Looks like this demon is stuck hero powering this turn. That's the downside of Overload, preventing him from being able to use all 3 of his mana crystals.
That's true. Like the thing that we see here that kind of is good for this demon, however, is that the Flame Wraith, the Faceless, is not going to have a counter
look
from Rage's side.
Oh my goodness, perfect ability to snipe all these 1-1s with the Ravaging Ghoul. This is what you need to be able to stabilize this warrior, but here comes the real test.
Like that's the real test, but
you can remove it now.
Yes, he can. He could have removed it as well with like a bash and coin revenge, but that's probably going to be better. Just go for the shield slam. Go for the shield block first, go for the shield slam afterwards, and trade in the ghoul.
Okay. So, warrior has stabilized for now. Now, just because they stabilized here doesn't mean that the game has been decided by any means.
Ooh!
That being a potential thing that really starts swinging it back in his favor. Totem Golem off the Tuskar Totemic is not pretty.
Yeah, like, oftentimes this is like a... It's something that's kind of like almost demoralizing to see from the opponent. But in this situation, it was actually like the least that this demon kind of could hope for. He's doing so bad that it was something that he certainly needed, and he's still losing, I would say.
Yeah. At least he's above 20 health. Usually, when you're like in the teens, it starts getting really scary at this point because Doomhammer came up, but. He still has ways to be defensive, remove a little bit of the board. He's playing Acolyte because he needs to improve the quality of his hand.
Yep.
This game is going fast and furious, though.
It really is. This Tuskar Totemic, if he picks up something good from it. But there is the Brawl waiting, so it might get played, but don't. I would say that's pretty good. This demon has a decision here because he might choose to play around Brawl, but I gotta say that the. In this matchup, in a situation like this, I think you just gotta go for it. Just play the abusive and try to push in as much damage as possible. Like hero powering, I don't know if it's gonna win the game for him, but there is the brawl, so this might work out slightly better than the abusive would have.
Yeah, I tend to agree. Like the longer you wait, especially with Acolyte on the board, the higher chance you give for them to draw the brawl to be more impactful. However, I do also recognize that you haven't gotten your opponent to the critical health state where you're basically pushing to win.
Yeah,
you're just at 25.
There's also the double revenge that this demon knows that Great Jay is playing, so can't really blame him for that. He's gonna go for a brawl here.
Oh, choosing not to revenge and draw a card. Instead, opting to just try to see what he can get off that brawl, and he wins the brawl. A huge moment for Great Jay. As he is able to keep his Acolyte alive, which is not necessarily imposing to threaten his opponent, but also to just draw him the cards. Because he needs more cards to stabilize you.
Even a bad totem for this demon here, and just nothing going his way. Let's see if he picks up a good hero power.
Okay. He did manage to get that 100 hero power. Very important to keep that in check, but Jessica Truar can start pulling himself farther away from it.
I don't really think that the 100 hero power is going to be good enough. I think life that might have been much better, just trying to like maybe establish some kind of board, because unfortunately just with the abusive and like two charges remaining on the Doomhammer, I can't really imagine him being able to kind of like get together enough damage.
Yikes. But I mean, I gotta say, despite the fact that this demon is able to have that early game minion curve, oh, a second Doomhammer. Ooh. Okay, so he does have more damage, just drew 16 damage.
That's right. That's quite a bit. But the tank up is a huge deal. It kind of like negates the Doomhammer every time.
Yeah, it negates the Doomhammer, but at the same time, this team can just pick up the Rock Fighters. And, Greyjay's at the halfway point. It's not over yet.
Certainly not over. Gore Howl, not too helpful here. Just gonna go for a revenge. Maybe Elise and the tank up. Fighter War Axe also an option. Okay, so I think we're gonna see the coin tank up and the Elise after this.
Yeah, feels like the best option for him to just be defensive. You need to tank up every turn. And this demon needs to find a lot of help here. I think he needs to get back-to-back Rockbiters to win the game here.
Yeah, and is even that enough? It might be.
I think it would be because he can do 12 damage per turn. That's a lot, too.
That's actually like almost the same amount of damage. So he can push 6 damage this turn. Great Jay is going to go back to 16. Oh, that actually could potentially be enough.
It could be enough. Depending on his next draws, or depending if Greyjay picks up Ironforge Portal, if he picks up Shield Block. I mean, even the Golden Monkey itself wouldn't be bad. Execute doesn't help
good.
Him.
So this demon right now with 11 points of damage. So another Lava Burst. He hasn't played a single Rock Fighter yet.
Oh, he gets it! And that's going to wrap up the series. This demon has the 16 damage needed. Wow, that was such an explosive way to end the series. And Diz Demon goes on to the semifinals.
Yeah. I thought that he wouldn't, without the life tap, he wouldn't be able to sustain. The second Doom Hammer, that is so huge. Getting that Lava Burst, getting that Rock Power, everything's just lined up. And Great Jay, unfortunately for him, was unable to find another card to get in armor with.
Yeah, it was back and forth from the Tuskar Totemics to the Brawls. It was emotional roller coaster. At the very end, Diz Demon has survived 4-3, the closest series of the day, by a long mile. We have Diz Demon almost ready for a couple of words with the interview. He's going to be playing the winner of Dr. Hippy versus Like a Boss. TJ is waiting for a couple of words.
That's right, guys. I'm standing by with Diz Demon after that marathon of a match. 2.5 hours, I think that was. What was going through your mind like halfway through that series after you're already like in when it was tied and it was an hour and a half in? How was that series for you?
It was really hard. I was not really in the match at the beginning. I played really bad, and I just decided to like play more quickly and hope I was playing a bit better.
Are you feeling confident moving forward in the semifinals now that you have a match under your belt on the stage?
Yeah, I think I will play better in the semifinal, and I need to get to the final.
All right, man. Well, good luck. Congratulations on your win. We're going to move into the final.